You love your house, but your family's outgrown it? Don't move. I'm Chip Wade, and I'll come in and make your home exactly what you need it to be.
Chip usually throws some kind of curve into the design that you're not expecting, so.
There's gonna be some kind of wall that folds up into the
something,
floor or something.
Yeah.
I came up with a special project for the master suite, and if I can get it to work, it's really gonna be incredible. It does have a track system that I'm gonna have to make from scratch, which is a moving element. I know, shocker.
I think one of the things I might have been nervous about was the bed with the moving parts and the size of it, but it fits in the room so perfectly. It's so easy to move.
Anytime we create something custom, I want to make sure it doesn't look store-bought. It has to be specialized to where it fits a space so definitively that there's no way it would be mass-produced. This gives any project a level of customization and personalization that's really meaningful.
Oh my gosh!
Gorgeous!
He has used every inch of that basement and maximized the space even far beyond what I thought he could. I'm speechless, really.
It blows my mind that he actually took just pieces of wood and then actually made a clock that operates. Just really talented that he could do that.
I struggle with doing things the easy way, mainly because I don't like to do what everybody else does.
To say bunk beds, it doesn't look like bunk
beds. No, it doesn't. It's like a multi-tier TV viewing station.
There you go. There you go.
A lounge Pellini.
Lounge Pellini.
We're going to coin
lounge
that.
Lounge Pellini.
Which is like a combination of 10 things.
Yep.
It's a conglomerate of all the best things.
Bev came to me and told me that Tom wanted something to make him feel as though he doesn't have to be constantly cleaning up the kitchen. So what I'm doing is installing the countertop that Stephen glued up for me on top of the existing granite countertop. This is going to be a sliding platform that goes from the main kitchen where the mess is made, slides through a partition into the back kitchen where the secondary sink and dishwashing is. So what Tom's gonna be able to do is make his mess, stack it on a countertop, open a door, slide it through, close the door, and party.
Who does that? Chip Wade.
Chip Wade.
Chip Wade.
Really, anybody can make a room look great with a lot of money. That's not hard. What's difficult is when funds are limited. That's when you really have to let creativity really take control. It'll be a big renovation, it will be messy, but I will give you exactly what your family needs.
Chip has proven time after time that you might not know where he's going, but once he gets there, it's a fabulous, wonderful product.
This is not going to affect us just for the next few months, or this will be years and years to be a place that we'll enjoy and just grow with family and extended family and all.
It's a dream come true.
Hey, everybody. I could hear them murmuring when they saw your stuff. Were you
love
murmuring?
That.
There was murmuring. I heard. You're amazing. You really are.
Well, we work hard. Yeah. But there's a lot of talented people besides me that make these shows. Yeah.
Did I see a horse in the one house?
It was a barn.
Right.
It was a barn. It transitioned from a barn to a house, but the people were such animal people that I couldn't do this in my own house. But that's the beauty of designing
right.
for people.
But the horse did not have access to the house.
No, it was still on the outside through a completely exterior wall. But
that's
it was
brilliant.
Like, so they were like eating your Cheerios next to the horse eating hay. It's
that's amazing.
Fun.
I would imagine. I wonder if the horse watches you eat, though, kind of like, hey, over here.
Yeah. What's with the weird diet?
Right, exactly. What are those little O's?
Exactly.
So you're here actually. First of all, I want to talk to you about all the stuff that you've done with HGTV, which is many and you are still doing. And you're also working with Liberty Mutual right
I
now.
I am. Actually, I recently partnered with Liberty Mutual, and it's great because they do all kinds of outreach and surveys that give great stats that kind of credentialize a lot of the trends that we're seeing. So, like I said, it's a great partnership, and they do fun things.
And your business is all about following trends and staying ahead of them and kind of on top of them.
To a degree, and knowing what's good and what not to look at. Yeah,
exactly. Is there anything that you've ever done that, like, the horse thing is amazing.
Yep.
The sliding countertop I thought was amazing. And was there anything that you've ever done that when you got done, you're like, oh, wait, I don't know if this was
well, good. That's, no, because I never, it's not done. So
okay.
that's the essence of when we do shows for HGTV or when we do them for private clients. A lot of what we focus on is
making sure that the final product is fantastic.
Right.
I never claimed to be the best designer ever. My background was actually all in engineering. I was a mechanical engineer before I ever started with HGTV.
So what would you have done if you weren't doing this?
You know, I have no idea. I was sitting at my office.
So you just decided I'd be a mechanical engineer without any real idea of what that...
It was even less planned than that.
Like, I would have been like, I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm going to do liberal arts. Like, wouldn't you have been like, not, like, mechanical engineering seems like there's a lot of...
Well, I had a landscaping company in high school. I almost didn't even go to college.
Okay.
I thought, you know what? I should go to college. I went to Georgia Tech down in Atlanta.
Mm-hmm.
I picked mechanical engineering because it was the most broad, because I didn't know what I wanted to do. But
it is broad.
I was handy and a very hard worker. And I became a structural engineer after because I loved to build things.
Right.
And that's where I was when I was sitting one day, got a random call for a show. People say, how did you get on HGTV? Well, there's not a proven method.
Yeah, how did you get on?
Answered a spam email.
It wasn't a spam, man. No. What happened?
So basically, I was sitting in my cubicle, and a producer, still to this day I've never met, he emailed. He used to live in my old neighborhood in downtown Atlanta, and he was looking for homes to be renovated for this new series called Design to Sell. So they weren't looking to cast people. They were looking for homes to be renovated.
Okay, you would have been the homeowner getting a makeover.
Exactly. And I was like, I don't need that, right? And I was like, don't they need a hotshot young engineer to be a cameo appearance on their show?
Right. Yeah.
So I basically just sent back a self-promotional email about myself.
Yeah.
Never struggle with self-confidence.
Right.
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 Never struggle with self-confidence. It doesn't pay off. And then just some projects that I had done. One thing led to another. I ended up getting cast as like the sidekick carpenter on a show called Design to Sell. And then hard work and fortune and...
Right.
You know, blessing.
I think your parents probably told you if ever someone you never met wants you to be on a TV show and sends you a spam email, they probably told you not to respond. But this is one case where it actually
exactly. worked. I was like, you know what? And I still thought it was just for a cameo appearance. I didn't realize it was actually for like a position on the
show. So when they gave you the job, you still thought it was one episode?
Didn't until, but this was like 6 months later.
Oh, okay.
So it was a long process. I kind of forgotten about
TV takes a while.
It does.
Yeah.
But we've learned a lot over the years.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So now what are people doing now? What are the trends right now?
People are building.
Yeah.
People are building. People are doing DIY. It's a huge, massive trend. In fact, according to one of these studies that Liberty Mutual did, about a third of all of us in the next year are going to be doing some type of home renovation project.
Wow.
So if you're thinking about it, you're not alone. A lot of us are doing DIY. A lot of the millennials are taking over a huge piece of the market, especially like from the real estate side. You guys are buying so many more houses, and your purchasing power is
Are you guys buying a lot of houses? I mean,
you will be.
Yes. Okay.
You
okay.
will be.
So can I get a part of that? That's amazing.
Well, again, we're sitting in Manhattan right now.
Right.
But as a national front, this age group is a powerhouse and is absolutely changing the course of the home and lifestyle category.
Wow. Okay, so we probably have a lot of people here who are renting, though, right? Do you have a lot of people who are renting spaces? What advice would you give? Hey, what advice would you give to people who want to make a change in a rental space?
Well, I am your guy for that because everything that I do is multi-purpose, and that multi-purpose is the essence. And I'm not talking about something that's just kind of novelty. I'm talking about something that actually takes the place of two or three or even four functions in one thing. So think surfaces,
right.
And think large pieces of furniture. There's a lot of brands out there that try to make a mass market type of product,
uh-huh.
but I would advise you guys to not just look at that as your only options.
Right.
Look at a couple of functions that you have in your own studio or your own apartment,
uh-huh.
figure out what those are, and if there's a seating arrangement that is just not working because they're too close, figure out a way of combining them together. That's literally the first step in a multi-purpose design. And these ideas don't necessarily come to you overnight. I've done so many renovations over the past 11 years. I counted up last month, we've done just over 1,100 renovations between television and private clients.
That's amazing.
In the past 11 years. Sometimes the designs come quick. Sometimes it takes a little bit of time, but we just don't stop until it gets right. Now, even if you're not creative, sit with it, mull over it. What we do in my design firm is the first 80% of our entire design process is ideation phase.
Yeah.
I think the vast majority of folks... even in the industry that are in design, and especially homeowners, I think you guys are only actually experiencing the last 20% of the design process because you go straight to looking at inspiration imagery and trying to execute and shove somebody else's solution into your architecture. Well, what's going to happen is you get somebody else's solution that's not made specifically for your particular space. So give it time. Let yourself actually be creative. Even if you think you're not creative, and even if, in fact, you're not, that's okay. give it time and something great will come.
Oh, that's cool. Okay, so what is your favorite part? Because you have some people that like scream, it's demo day, or you have some people that are like, it's the move-in, or like, what is your favorite part and what's your least favorite part?
Okay, so it's different with television versus a private client. You watch television, things happen in a beginning, middle, and end real quick, right? Fast, 22 minutes.
Yeah.
In real life, it takes a little bit longer than that. However, my favorite part is actually seeing the entire story from start to finish. I am a progress fiend. I love to see something start, the idea come, and then see it executed, and then see it delivered, and then start it all again.
Right. Demo seems very tiring. Like, I feel like demo's where all the getting hurt happens.
Well, demo for real is very methodical. It's very pre-planned. And in fact, if you're doing construction and renovation correctly, there's not a whole lot of drama to it because you really need to come to the table with much more of a vision of where you're going. And so the process becomes very, very systematic. Right. So demo is great. It's ultra visual. Yeah. That's, I think for homeowners, demo is one of the most exciting parts on that side of the cards because they see massive change happen. But what happens is right after demo, it seems like progress halts, even though things are still happening.
Yeah.
It's just visually there's a little bit of a lull before we kind of kick back up again.
You've helped people sell their homes on TV and off of television. So what advice would you give to people? Like, you actually have kind of a tip, a secret to getting people to sell their houses a little bit more easily behind the scenes.
Well, as far as a tip for selling them more easily, there is a strategy that we use. So just so you guys know, aside from the television stuff, we have a really functioning, a real functioning architecture and design firm. My company's called WadeWorks Creative. We service people nationwide. So we have a full service team there. We also do real estate and we do some production work as well. So these teams together, we actually are collaborating, and I'm kind of going in a little bit of a different direction to kind of set the stage for the types of services that you guys are going to see out there in the marketplace, not just from people like myself, but hopefully people that are popping up all over the country, which are leveraging different disciplines for the sake of the entire relationship with the client. So it's not just going to be designers or real estate agents or inspectors or other financial advisors acting independently, because let's be honest, that's cumbersome. When you do that, you're a homeowner that's busy with a proficiency of doing something else, and you just want all the answers. And instead of going to your real estate agent, your designer, your financial expert, your friend that you trust their design, having a resource that answers all of those questions in one place, that is the key to making sure that you get what you need.
And you have a live streaming show on DIY.
So we just started this about, I guess, 2 months ago. It's called Life Skills with Chip Wade. We started on DIY's Facebook channel, so we're kind of piloting a new episodic content series on Facebook, which
is really exciting. Follow HGTV on Facebook and DIY Network on Facebook.
That's right.
And then you can find
Absolutely. So it's called Life Skills. We're about to kick up a new one on HGTV's channel. So the one on DIY is going to be much more hands-on, tactical, a little bit more how-to oriented.
Yeah.
The series on HGTV's is going to be a little bit more project driven. So you're going to see a project from start to finish, and these things are not that long. So I'm actually going between 30 minutes and about 45 minutes, which for a live broadcast is long.
Yeah, that's a long time.
Got to give me a second to get some stuff done.
You need the glue. the glue needs to dry.
That's right. We might have to staple it to hold it.
Right. Exactly. Okay. And also, if you're trying to sell your house, is it helpful to have like a plan for people of the house? Like you also mentioned that.
Yes. So from a design standpoint, one of the things that we do, and again, whether you guys are renting, whether you own the place or you don't, having what I call a master plan approach is absolutely fundamental. It's kind of that part of that 80% design process that I was talking about a lot of people graze over. Just a quick story. If you imagine, say you want to do one portion of your house this year, you save up, you go and you execute, maybe you're happy with it. Next year, maybe you get a little bit more money and you want to go and you want to do the next room over. Well, if you didn't design them together, you're going to see that previous room and be like, oh, if I'd have just done this differently, right? So having the overall vision of the entire property mapped out, even if you never get there, is an amazing tool, not only for your execution, but also even if you were to sell your house. People struggle with vision. They struggle with knowing what to do with the space and how. Imagine you had that fully fleshed out plan of that entire structure laid out. Say, this is the game plan, and this is the cost rollout of how this is going to happen. It's an amazing sales tool. We've had clients that leverage that just to sell their house that never even executed any of the work.
Wow. Okay, design trends right now that you're over or are into.
Oh, gosh, design trends are those interesting things. I'm not against trends, but I'm also not for them. You just have to look at them through a good mirror. There's things that are out there that I'm seeing everywhere that are kind of don't invest in right now, which florals is a huge thing from it. We'll cover some decor things and we'll cover some function things. A lot of brushed metal.
What about florals? I just think it's funny to see you talk about florals.
Typically when people talk trends, I more like to talk trends when it comes to decor.
And so that's one that's hot right now.
It's kind of on the downslope.
Okay. And what was the next one you said?
Brushed metals.
Okay.
Brushed metals is one where we're seeing a little bit more the sleek coming back in.
Okay.
So even like with your appliances, black appliances kind of came. Did anybody see those? Right?
Yeah.
The kind of novelty.
Are they back?
But
are they
Not black specifically, but more matte metal.
Oh, got it. Okay.
It's good. Okay. So black, I wouldn't go out and buy a set of black appliances right now. Stick with either your stainless or the matte.
Got it.
The technology-driven spaces is a trend that is moving strongly in the upward direction. Mm-hmm. So these are tech-enabled spaces, mainly your living rooms and your bathrooms. Mm-hmm. There's so many products that are coming available that are working really, really well in tandem with lifestyle.
Right.
So making it not just something novelty to control from your smart device, but something that saves energy, that saves time, peace of mind, all of these types of things.
I changed my thermostat with my phone.
Yeah.
Which is, honestly, the thermostat's like right over there, so it is a little lazy right now in the size of place I have, but it's great that you can do that. And you're working on virtual spaces now, too.
Yes. So one of the most exciting things that we're doing on our production side of our business is creating completely virtual environments, meaning these are environments that don't actually exist. So you've probably seen aspirational pictures that you've seen that have been computer renderings. Well, over the past about a year and a half, we've gotten that technology to a place to where it's literally indistinguishable between reality.
Well, I was reading that the IKEA catalog, like more than half of the rooms that you see in the catalog are fake. They're not real. They're all
IKEA, one thing that they have going
for
them.
Which I love IKEA, don't get me wrong.
All their products are very sleek lined, shiny, and flat, which is the best case scenario for that type of technology. But now we're not even limited to that type of architecture. We're doing things all the way to the nth degree where you're able to walk around, interact with, and even all the way through point of purchase in these types of environments. So be watching out. Spring of 2018 is the time where a lot of brands and your e-commerce platforms are going to start embracing some of this. So from your design to your product selection, it's coming.
So it's a way to shop then.
It's a way to shop.
It's like shopping in Avatar land. What's the name of the Avatar world?
That's good.
What's it called? Pandora, right.
Thank you. Wow, we needed help.
A little bit of a sidetrack. We needed help.
You know, it is. I mean, and a lot of it is the difference between, you know, 3 years ago, if you'd have thought an expectation to have something bought on Amazon or something and show up 2 days later would be impossible.
Now it's an expectation.
So you're like, why can't I buy something and have it show up soon?
Right.
The same regard, this type of interface and concierge type of interactive environment where you guys feel like you're in control, you're driving, you're looking at what you want to look at, you look away from what you don't care about, and you're going to be shopping that way, and the information is going to be more driven.
I still want to feel the couch, though, Chip. I still want to feel it.
Well, I believe that there's going to be a hybrid, and this comes I work with a lot of different brands in the home category, and I see a lot of what's happening. I don't think there's ever going to be a complete replacement for physical location, but we're going to start seeing more boutique design shops where there is a virtual environment and a selection of product that does give you that tangible look. But you want to lay on that velvet, which velvet, by the way, also is coming back.
Is it? Okay.
Yeah. So again, whatever. I'm not sure if that means anything to you guys, but in the home decor space, it's going to be coming back.
Yeah. Okay. So wait. So you can like try on it. What do you mean? What do you mean? I don't know what you mean about the couch thing.
So this is interesting. So imagine this. Imagine you're in a store that's maybe no bigger than this stage, and the three walls are interactive screens, right? Imagine there's some type of projection device that's on the ceiling that projects onto the floor, but the floor has different texture maps. So let's say we're talking about flooring, right? So maybe there's a rough scraped texture. Maybe there is a certain weave of carpet,
right?
But it's all white, so you walk over them. But when the image is cascaded over the entire room, you get the vantage point of actually seeing the mid-size area.
Got it.
And then actually being able to go and put your fingers on it and touch it, even though it's versatile. Okay. We should do a show on this.
You should. You should do a show on that. Okay, now what, this is a sidetrack question.
Yeah.
What do you eat when you get up in the morning? What
Oh my goodness.
You have a little bit of energy, I'm just saying.
I am high energy.
I do not have that energy level. My
diet
jealous.
My diet is awful.
No, shut up.
I'm
now when you see people who are in shape, like, oh, I eat like a pig, you don't believe one, you don't believe
it's
it.
It's a candy shell. It looks hard on the outside, but it's not.
Okay. All right.
I'm very
what's your idea of
very,
awful?
Very cyclical. Okay. I'm either all in or all out with fitness and with diet. Okay. I wish my motivation was all about health. I really do. That would be so noble. But
you were
really
in like men's fitness or men's health for once, or right?
A couple times. And you take lots of pictures so you can slowly distribute them, which is another skill set.
What do you mean? You take a lot, and then you'd be like, here's my latest photo.
And then you slowly let them go to make people think that you're always in shape.
Well, that's what I did my profile photo on Facebook. Yeah, it's like, exactly. Like 3 years ago.
It's really a strategy.
That's what Facetune is for.
No, I mean, I generally, portion control is my nemesis, right. But for breakfast, per se, okay. I usually eat 2 eggs, like an avocado and some small tomatoes. That's kind of like my go-to.
Okay.
I either do that or I go straight to Waffle House, get the All-Star Special with hash browns, cheese, eggs, pecan waffle, raisin toast, probably drink 4 cups of coffee.
And an ambulance? Like what happens after that? Like, right? It's like,
I'll have to share that later. It's probably...
Right. Okay. What if you were giving advice to people who want to pursue the path that you're on?
Yeah.
And there is no one way.
There's not.
But what are some of the life lessons that you've learned along the way in doing what you do?
Well, I can't really take credit for the success
take credit
that
for
I've
working
had.
Hard, and,
working
and,
hard
and being nice to people.
A fundamental that I feel like it should go without saying,
right.
It does not. Mm-hmm. Being kind to people, never be above any task ever, ever. So even as a host, as a producer of my own series, you will see me being the first one on set, the last one to leave. I will be on my hands and knees cleaning the backside of some random stranger's toilet or cleaning out a pee trap, which is disgusting.
Right. And you don't even know the person.
No.
Right.
But guess what? Your entire team that you rely on rallies around you when they know that you will do those things.
Yeah.
I mean,
working
hard is a huge thing. And kind of jumping back to what you said earlier, I don't claim to be the best at anything. I just have a vision that I know what's good, and I don't stop until I get there.
Yeah.
And however long that takes... That's really the...
And that can be applied to any line of work. Right.
Anything.
What was one of the hardest lessons you learned along the way, both doing your kind of construction and renovation side and the TV world?
Oh, my goodness. It's all having to do with people. It's all relationships, growing our business. It's managing people. People are amazing, but it's hard. It's a hard, hard thing. Knowing when I'm down in my workshop or in front of my computer, it's controlled, and I can control my entire environment. Mm-hmm. But when you mix people, and there's so many different things, but that is the ultimate thing that gives you the joy every day. Is I work so many hours, I've surrounded myself with the people that I want to be around. Not necessarily the things that I'm passionate about or that I really want to be doing, it's the people that I want to be around every day.
Do you find people always want things faster than they
should? Of course. Of course, but there's also education. When you're proficient at a certain vocation, whether it be home renovation like I am or something else, oftentimes I have to give people the vegetables, right? But
right.
It's a shorter term lull in disappointment for a longer term gain. So being very, very confident in what you do allows you to have those types of conversations and get you to the end game where everybody needs to be.
And if you don't want to be hurrying all the time, make cheese. Because nobody's like, where's my cheese? Like, it's like, it takes...
That's good.
It takes
good.
Time.
And you appreciate the...
Cheese takes time.
That's right.
that's always the job that... You know, like, we all those days, you're like, I'm done. You know? And I'm like, I'm going to go make cheese. Because nobody says hurry up with the cheese. Like,
that's when I just eat string
cheese. It needs six months. It needs to age, like me.
Have you ever made cheese, Brian?
No, but my nieces ended up making cheese, and
really?
I saw it.
Was
and
it good?
It didn't look fun.
I can't imagine.
But, like,
it
they did
good,
it every day. But anyway, it's not about me.
I'm kind of intrigued with
you
the cheese.
You know how
making.
Many times I've said that here in this forum? It's not about me because I go off on a tangent. We have questions that I'd like to field from the audience. Hey.
Hi.
How are you?
So, my parents just became empty nesters,
okay.
And so they want to make some kind of renovation project happen at the house because they haven't really done anything since I was like in the second grade. So, but the thing is, they're kind of nervous of change.
Yes.
So how can I kind of help calm the nerves saying like, it's okay, you can like mess around with the house now?
Well, if they're waiting on you, then you definitely need to say that.
I feel like you tell it like it is though.
Yeah.
She's one of my faves here.
Okay. I mean, your parents are going through an emotional time right now, even though they're kind of probably breathing through it. It's hard. I work with so many different families that are kind of at different phases of life. I think encouraging them to have more experiential type of infusion into their home. It doesn't have to be high level design. It has to be, think 5 to 7 years out. This is just a, whether it's your parents, whether it's you guys, I always like to design, well, maybe not you guys that are specifically mostly in college. Once you kind of, once that next phase out, you want to design out about 5 to 7 years. And then just put in the things that you love. If you're going to be in that location, if your parents are going to be there at least 7 years, then it doesn't honestly matter. Make it exactly what you want. Things are going to change before then anyways. If you're going to be before that, then there's maybe some other strategy that needs to come in. But I try to free people's minds to say, you know what? Do what you want. Don't care what your friends say. What do you want to wake up to? Make that one special spot first. Prioritize one place, one thing, one item, right. Something that you can, that makes you happy, that may make no sense to anybody else. That's going to give you an internal motivation to appreciate your space that you're creating and spend the money and time that it's going to actually take to finish the rollout.
Unless it's black appliances. Anyway.
Don't do it.
No. Have you done your parents or in-laws places?
I have. I designed my in-laws. They moved about 3 miles down. We're very family
oriented.
That's done.
Close.
My parents live with us.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so okay. I have 3 young children. I have a 4, a 6, and an 8-year-old, 2 boys and a girl. So we're kind of in that phase of life. Our house is probably too big, but it's great.
Not if you have 3 kids. I feel like that's, you know.
But it's nice for them to, and another thing for parents is just to have a whole level or area that is just kid land. Because you're just not going to combat the crazy crap that happens with Kidland.
Yeah.
I have a whole nice area for my parents. They have their whole master bedroom, 2 big living rooms, a kitchen, a master bath, all upstairs. But they have their own space where they can block us off.
Nice.
But they're close proximity. My in-laws are really close. We do all this kind of stuff for family.
Do we have another question? Yeah.
Hi. I was just curious. What was your favorite house to design?
Oh, gosh, that's a great question. I need to just come up with a lie answer that's very concise.
Yeah, maybe not.
because
you've had the things that I love elements about, that you loved, right?
Yeah, the things that I love with designs probably are not what you guys would relate to, even seeing it on television. They don't necessarily correlate. There's little things. I'll do custom projects for homeowners that don't even make air. All right, but it's that one little thing that maybe didn't have a fully robust enough story to include. It might be a distraction to the programming, but afterwards, there's a real connection with that homeowner that knows that I did something very specific that was personalized and individualized for them that may not even be hidden or that may not be very visible. That is the type of thing that means the most, honestly. That's the real, win for design in general. It's not just the beauty. Making a space look beautiful, by the way, is absolutely the easy part. There's tons of talent out there, tons of talent. But making a space that actually works and that is meaningful, that takes that 80% that few people really, really engage with to the fullest.
Right. One more? Do we have time for one more? Ah, here we go.
Hi, how are you?
Good, thank you.
I was wondering, who are your favorite people that you've met, either in your own business or through the show?
Oh, man. I've met famous people, but really my favorite people are not very well-renowned. A lot of times it's just that one family that is just so appreciative.
Yeah.
That's the awesome part. And they are all over the place. But you only find them by doing great work for people. When you really pour yourself into something, when there's not a ton of cameras on you, when you just have your own humdrum, no fancy job, you can get the same fulfillment for going over and beyond, and what's going to propel your personal business, whether it's kind of public facing or behind the scenes, is when you have that type of ethic and you touch those people. Anything that you have 10 years down the road is going to be exclusively contingent upon the relationship that you created with those people, with your clients. All whether it's, again, we call it clients, design clients. It doesn't matter who it is. Those touches, you're going to get more business. I get more business from the clients that I have absolutely poured myself into for years and years and years, from referral, all those types of things. That does more for your business as a growth strategy. Like I said, a lot of us won't be accountants or whatever else where you build like this book of business, right, where it kind of grows and grows and grows, but you do. You don't realize that that's what you're doing, but every single person you interact with, if you guys are doing internships or anything right now, Work hard, but meet everybody you possibly can, and don't just be someone standing over in the corner. Be bold. Go say hello. Get their information. Follow up relentlessly. Relentlessly. Things will happen. That is the work ethic that makes the huge difference.
He's working really hard, so give him a break.
Yeah, thank you, thank you. Exactly.
Just kidding.
Exactly.
Unless you're that guy in the corner who's like busting it right now.
I'm just kidding. Just kidding. He's like, tell me about it.
How can people find you on social?
All of my handles are at Chip Wade. Pretty easy. I got in early. Chipwade at Gmail as well if you need to email me.
Yeah, there we go. Exactly. All right. We're like, let's all email him like later, like all at once.
That's right. My wife hates it when I give out my personal information, but it is what it is.
But you know what? If you're trying to reach a celebrity, generally try their name at Gmail. Like it usually does get through, truthfully.
That's
it's like the worst kept secret.
Yeah, we're not that creative.
And then try to, yeah. All right. Thank you so much, Chip.
Thank you, Brian. I appreciate you having me. Thank you.